Hi, hier ist Danny Ajaf and I'm presenting today on CEF Security and give you some insight into SEPRA requirements, attack vectors and some pitfalls you can have with security. I'm working for Deutsche Telekom on CEF topics and I'm also an upstream developer in the community. So give you a short intro. You all probably have seen this picture before about CEF. We have some major parts which are RADOS as underlying layer to store objects, and we have some backends like RADOS gateway, which is a REST API gateway, or RADOS block devices, or CEFFS. There are some components in CEF. One are the monitors or MONs, which are very lightweight daemons and have using a PEXOS protocol and to find the leader of the monitors, and are usually or always in an odd number deployed. And the monitor maintains a map of the cluster state and handles authentication. On the other side, we have the object storage daemons, or short OSDs, which are smart storage daemons. They coordinate with each other and handle all the stuff around data replication, recovery, backfilling, and rebalancing. And the storage backend behind that is currently BlueStore. Before we had FileStore, but now it's BlueStore, which utilizes raw storage devices to handle the data, and has also a K-value store and write-ahead log. We have also the metadata service which you need for CEFFS to provide a POSIX compliant shared file system. It handles also the directory hierarchy and file metadata. And there's also multi-MDS support to have various combinations like multi-active, standby, standby replay, and hot standby. And it coordinates also the access to the shared file system. The RADOS gateway is a RESTful gateway to either Amazon S3 APIs or Swift, and it has a separate user management. One relatively new component in CEF is the CEF Manager daemon, which runs alongside the MONs to provide additional monitoring, interface with external monitoring, and also interface with external management and orchestrators. It's very flexible through modules, which are loaded via Python subinterpreter. And it's also the backend for the CEF dashboard module. It's a built-in web management monitoring module with multi-user and role management, single sign-on is supported, as well as SSL TSL support and auditing. If you take a look on the network side of CEF, you have either supported IPv4 or IPv6 currently. There's always a public interface, which is the network to the clients, and you have always a cluster network which handles all the replication data and everything that is needed around recovery, heartbeats, and so on. And there's a number of ports opened or required to run CEF, which are listed here. You can take a look on it. You probably need it to handle your firewall. If we speak about security, we also have to speak about data management to fully understand what's going on. The data can be distributed either through replication, which means simply you have a copy of an object n times in your system, depending on your configuration. And with, for example, 3 times replication, you have at least an overhead of 200%. It's very fast on read and very quicker on recovery. And the other solution you can choose is erasure coding, which is basically one copy plus parity. It's something comparable or also used in RAID systems. It's very space efficient. You need less space than with replication, but there's a performance impact on small objects, and the expense recovery process is very expensive, in meaning it needs time and compute power. Replication looks like that. As I said before, you have an object you write from your client to a primary OSD, and from there, full copies will distribute it to, depending on your configuration, your second, third, or more OSDs. With erasure coding, it's a little bit different. The object is, in this case, depending on the algorithm you use for erasure coding, cut into n pieces, and k codes they are used to later recover from there if one OSD is lost, and then it's distributed. That means, in this case, you have less than the 200% overhead. If you speak about security, also data integrity is important to have consistency and cleanliness in your data. There are some processes in CEF to handle that. One is scrubbing, which compares the metadata on a placement group with the peers of the other OSDs. And that is usually, depending on your configuration, done daily, on a daily basis. And it catches some bugs and flaws you have potentially in CEF. And on the other hand, you have deep scrub, which is really doing a bit-by-bit comparison between placement groups. And that is less often. Usually it's by default, I think it's weekly. You can catch with that also bad sectors, which are not found by normal scrubbing or something like bit flips in your system. CEFFS itself provides additional scrubbing. One is forward scrubbing, which ensures the file system consistency, and backward scrubbing is verifying each RAS object to the process. On data deletion, it's important to know if you delete an object in CEF, independent of from which backend it's directly it's destroyed on RADOS on the underlying layer. And the deletion of a pool does destroy all related RADOS objects. If you have a pool with for a RADOS block device and you delete that, then all RADOS block devices are gone. They are not recoverable over deletion, but you have to know that there can be residual data artifacts on depending on your storage that may be there till it's overwritten, really. So you could recover probably something if it's not overwritten, but it will be quite hard. On CEFFS, it's a little bit different. The file, if you delete a file, is marked as deleted in the metadata server, and then delayed, lazily deleted are the RADOS objects. And you have to keep in mind, in general, that on one hand, snapshots can still hold data in CEF. So you probably, if you need to delete files from an user, you probably also need to handle the files in the snapshots. And client-side encryption of data protects from everything. And if the key is destroyed, it's gone. So let's come to the security topics. So some general considerations. You have, as you know, classical threat actors like nation-state actors, organized crime, hacktivist or highly capable groups that could attack you. You have motivated inside people that probably could attack you from the inside. But you also have these typical script kiddies, which are not that well trained, but still a threat. You have to consider, is your CEF an internal cluster in general, or is it exposed to customers, or is it even exposed to the internet? You also should really know which services or APIs you expose. And you have to understand your security requirements and your internal standards you have. Also services that you enable and the security risks that implies. You also really should take a deeper look on who has access to your cluster by default and to really know what the attack surface on the cluster is. We have some general issues here with attack surface on CEF. It's not monitored systems and networks are really bad, not really regularly updated and patched setups like the OS and Ceph itself is also an issue. One of the biggest issues is probably no automation. Everything that is managed by hand and deployed by hand usually ends up in a weird state and can pretty easily be attacked. Not hardened systems is a general issue with all systems, as you know. And not audited security requirements will also lead to problems. And at the end, not aware and trained SIST admins are a big threat to your system, so you should take care on that. In general, we have the topic of flaws and bugs with Ceph. The issue here is that if you have an issue in Ceph itself, in one daemon, it affects all daemons of this type, at least of this type. It could also affect other ones. You could have denial of service attacks. As an example, you could open many connections to Ceph and could have a denial of service. You could also submit very many or large or small or an otherwise expensive I.O. to the cluster to bring it down. And you could for sure use flaws in Ceph to crash daemons. Shut down the convol cluster. And you could also identify some non-obvious but very expensive features in Ceph interfaces, which could lead to high impact load on your cluster to bring it down. From the network side, client and cluster sessions prior to Nautilus, the Nautilus release, haven't been encrypted. So you could read data that is written or read from the network. Sessions itself are authenticated with CephX, which is the authentication protocol of Ceph. You couldn't impersonate clients or daemons, and there shouldn't be any man-in-the-middle attacks that shouldn't be possible. Also, TCP session hijacking is disabled by that way. So if you take a deeper look on CephX, it's a Kerberos-based protocol. It has unique keys for each entity in the cluster, for each daemon and for each client. And it has capabilities assigned to the keys, and the keys are stored in the mons. They are usually stored in plain text on the client machine, but could be an issue. You could have compromised host or stolen keys in this case, or leakage of keys, for example, due to debug messages. And you could also have, as always, exploits and flaws in your protocol. And very often, is an issue that you have to write capabilities for a certain user. If you take a look on the different parts of Ceph, we have the Rados gateway on one side, which provides S3 and Swift. This only provides network access to the Rados gateway through this API and no direct access to another client, which is good. On the other hand, you have Rados gateway admin, which can add and remove users and do some admin tasks. So you have an API attack surface in this case. On the Rados block device, which is used for virtualization usually, it is protected by a hypervisor layer if you use it for a VM. At the guest level, there's no access to the network from off Ceph and no access to keys, which is good. But as you always know, hypervisors are only software, so there are known issues or have been known issues, and there will probably be issues in the future about hypervisors, so you could break through. The attack service for the Rados block device host is there's no protection at all if you use the kernel interface. If the host is compromised, the attacker has complete access to the keys on the host, the public network, and through the daemons or to the daemon network, or directly if you use hyperconverged infrastructure. If you take a look on CephFS, the issue here is that you have direct access to the public network of the Ceph cluster. It has the same attack vectors like a host attack. Plus, you have access to files of other users potentially. You can get access to that. You could fill up the file system if you don't manage that right. And you could probably do privilege escalation for these files. If you take a look now, the Ceph mons, you have the out base, also the authentication base, you could compromise probably. You could inject keys or manipulate manipulate keys capabilities. You could also extract keys, which would be an issue, and you could probably manipulate the configuration settings of the cluster. And the fully compromised mon is the best, the worst case scenario you could have. You could control the complete cluster, including all at rest encryption keys, probably. If you take a look on the itself manager, you could probably use flaws to load existing modules or load malicious modules. You could probably also replace valid modules on your disk with malicious code, but that would require local access to your machine. The modules are not loaded dynamically, and they are currently not verified or signed, so that is an issue. The Ceph dashboard is a typical web in the service. You could also have these HTTPS attacks or API attacks, including directory traversal to the root file system, flaws in authentication, role escalation, all that stuff you know from any web servers, brute force attacks on passwords. And it runs in the Ceph manager context, but it's stateless. It stores login information on several external services in the mon key value store, and it gives has full admin access. So there are some stuff you have to take care of. Proactive counter managers on security. So regarding your deployment, one is have always a separated cluster and public network. So either you do it physically or you do it through VLANs. That is depending on your setup. Always separate your control nodes from the other networks and from your other machines. Separate services which expose an API to an external from the rest. Clear. I would recommend not to expose your cluster to the internet directly. And probably you want to encrypt all inter data center traffic or any traffic that leaves your data center in general. You should enable the Ceph client host ports in your firewall and probably close everything else that would also have. So if you think about any hyper-converged infrastructure where you have control nodes mixed with the rest of the Ceph cluster, avoid it if possible. I wouldn't do that. Separate compute and storage in general. Scale them independently is one advantage in general. If you do it, you should at least do some kind of risk mitigation. Do not mix the control nodes with the compute and storage nodes in general. That is something you should never do. At least you should run Ceph then in a hardened container setup. But as an hypervisor, it's still software, so it could break through. If you take a look on Ceph X, on the authentication for Ceph, you should always enable it. These are the configuration keys you need for that. And use at least Nautilus as a release, which is SUSE Enterprise Storage 6, enable Ceph X version 2, because the first version has some flaws. The Ceph X key management, you should take a look on it. Separate keys for each client and users, restrict them to an absolute minimum. Distribute the keys only where really, really needed, and limit the permission on the key files. And you probably also want to limit the administration power or admin power on that. You could use some read-only caps or restrict the profile role or allow keys settings. Admin keys must only be distributed to any admin or management node, not any other node. And there are some to-dos we have currently think about. It's implementing something that is not only allowing capabilities, but strip them. Regarding hardening, always install the latest patches, harden your base system, never run Ceph as root, because you could also escalate and per default in SAS, it's, there's a Ceph user and a Ceph group for that. And you should probably enable mandatory access control, like UpArmor, which is part of SAS 6. And you may want to consider some services to be run as a container or an AVM. SAS 7 will containerize all services by default. So you could have denial of service contract attacks. You could limit the load from clients. In RBD, there's a QME throttling feature for that, and serverless routers, gateways, there are quotas for that. You should always monitor your system and check for false attempts on authentication and consider blacklisting IPs in special scenarios. There's a command for that. What we still in the community think about, it's there to limit the maximum number of open sockets per user or per OSD and throttle for sessions and clients. Encryption, you should, Ceph volume supports encryption, DM to DM encrypt. It encrypts the raw device with looks, and there's a separate key for each volume. There's no performance impact on modern processors. You should always encrypt your system if you are not sure that your disk is probably leaving at some point in time your data center. It makes it easy to discard them if the key for the secret is still safe. The encryption keys are stored by default in the monen. So you should probably make a backup copy of these keys and limit the access to these keys. It's part of SES6 already. You have encryption on wire also as a topic you could protect from listener on networks. That is supported with the Nautilus Messenger Protocol version 2. You can enable it through these configuration variables and enable the encryption for on-wire. For RS block devices, if possible, use the virtualization layer, apply quotas, and without the virtualization layer, should consider using iSCSI in between. For routers gateway, that is a very big target, as you know, and you should always enable HTTPS and SSL. And you could also put a small appliance in front of the routers gateway, which would do be a web application firewall and do the SSL termination, and could also use a separate network for that. So don't share any accounts and buckets between consumers. That would also be important. Regarding CephFS, there is no standard virtualization. You could do file system pass-through to the host. The performance is not that good on it. Direct access from host to VM is the topic here. And you could run a CephFS only cluster and not mix with other services to improve the security and enable quotas. And probably you should also consider going to an LFS gateway if there's still a security issue for you. Access control wise, you should restrict the mount parts for the users and also restrict the number of snapshots somebody can do. Really enable it only if it's needed, and in complexer setups, consider also network restrictions for the users. And you should also limit UIDs and group IDs for any user. Regarding the Ceph manager, it loads the modules on start, ensure only root, and the Ceph user has access to the modules directly on your system, and make sure you use mandatory access control to handle the modules. You could also run the Ceph manager in a container. We currently think about if it's making sense to have some kind of verification module for modules. Regarding the dashboard, only allow SSL, TSL, SSL for all web services. Handle separate user accounts with strong passwords, which is not sure if it's done already in Octopus. You should also clean up users if they are gone and not shouldn't have any access to your system. And you should limit roles and security scopes to a minimum. Monitor also the Ceph audit log to see if there's something happening you don't want, and consider using a web application firewall in front. Preventing breaches. We in the community run on a regular basis static code analysis with several tools to find issues, and also run runtime analysis to find bugs. And we have a very closed code review process. Regarding testing, we have unit tests and QA for each pull request. We are still in progress on pen testing to find really security issues that are not covered by any tests, and about the same is valid for fuzzy testing. to have automated tests on garbage input to see if something is happening. Build your system hardened in your way. I already said that you can build Ceph hardened. That is currently done in one or another way by all distros out there, with most of them use these flags for the build process. If you have, think about reactive countermeasures, what can we do to prevent brute force attacks? Logging of failed attempts and monitoring is very easy. What we're currently thinking about is how to automatically blacklist IPs after a number of attempts. Prevent unauthorized injection of keys, monitoring on the audit log, trigger always an alert, and that should be done in your monitoring. And you should probably also, on a periodic base, compare your out keys with these which are stored, and also the capabilities. On the security process in the community, we have a single point of contact for issues. You should simply write an email to security@ceph.io. It's not an email list you can subscribe to. It's only for a limited number of persons. It's for the core developer team, for security teams, from the distributions, and some selected community members. So you write an email to that, and you probably describe the issue you found, the affected Ceph version, how we can produce it. At best would be you also give a proof of concept. And for sure, every patch is welcome. So if you send that, the security team will contact you and handle the process. So we have a responsible disclosure process in the community, very strict SLA on issues which are raised in the distros. As you could already know from SUSE for other projects or other parts of the distribution. And we have a community security team strives and a CVE process and escalates everything to the Ceph developers, and the security related fixes are prioritized and probably backported depending on the version. Releases are maybe accelerated on the ad hoc basis. And issues get disclosed after agreed time frame, as you know from responsible disclosure processes. So security advisories are going through Ceph announce at Ceph.io. You should subscribe to that if you want to monitor that. So if you take, I took a look on the Ceph CVEs we had in the last few years. I don't want to go into the details of CVEs, but give you an overview on what we have in the last few years. As you can see, the number of CVEs increased, which is basically caused by the fact that there is more usage of Ceph, and we are very fast driving development. So, and the community is really getting better on finding also issues, and we get more, since the community is growing, more reports back from the outside currently. The number is increasing. It's not only coming from the distributions. So this year alone, we had 5 so far, and the community is really handling these processes. So a conclusion, short summary, security is quite complex, as you know. The community is aware about these problems and that security is important for you. The SUSE distribution is actively involved in the process as a part of it. There is, as far as I know, a SUSE best practice hardening guide on the roadmap. You should ask your SUSE contact when it's coming out. And always keep in mind, know your security requirements you have, harden your systems, and limit access and users. Only deploy itself in an automated way. I mean, even for a POC, I would always consider you doing it automated. Monitor your system and do a regular update on issues, and be very vigilant on all issues regarding security. And general consideration is you don't use anything before Ceph Nautilus, which is SUSE Enterprise Storage 6. So use something that is either that or newer, due to the authentication issues that we solved in there and improved. If you have any questions, feel free to either leave a message on the SUSE Con Digital webpage on the wiki, or you can simply send me an email directly to this address and I will answer you and help you out. Thank you.